Good morning. We have already derived simple harmonic motion equations using a mass spring system. Today we are going to derive the equations for simple harmonic motion of a simple pendulum using calculus.
Calculus!
Flippin' physics!
Again?
Bo, what is the equation for the period of a simple pendulum?
I thought we were deriving that.
We are, however, we have already worked with the equation, so I thought we would review it first.
Sure. The period of a pendulum equals 2 pi times the square root of the quantity length of the pendulum over little g, the gravitational field strength. And this equation is only valid if the pendulum angle is less than 15 degrees.
I thought little g was the acceleration due to gravity.
Gravitational field strength and acceleration due to gravity are the same thing.
That's right. Thanks.
Thank you, Bo. Bobby, what is the general equation which defines simple harmonic motion?
Oh, we went over this last time. The second derivative of position with respect to time equals the negative of the square of angular frequency times position, where angular frequency equals the square root of the quantity spring constant over mass.
Angular frequency only equals the square root of spring constant over mass for a mass spring system.
Right. The angular frequency is different for each type of system we are analyzing, so it'll be different for a pendulum. Yeah.
That is correct. What we are doing today is deriving the angular frequency of a simple pendulum, so we can use that to derive the period of a simple pendulum. Billy, please remind me what the restoring force for a pendulum is.
The restoring force for a pendulum...
But have we defined what a simple pendulum is yet?
Ah, good point, Bo. We've talked about it a bit. However, you are correct that we should specify exactly what it means to be a simple pendulum. So, Billy, what is a simple pendulum?
A simple pendulum? Aren't all pendulums simple?
No. All the pendulums we have worked with so far have been simple pendulums. However, most real-life pendulums are not actually simple pendulums. A simple pendulum is basically an idealized, simple version of a pendulum, hence simple pendulum.
Okay, so, for example, we have assumed the string of each of our pendulums has negligible mass. Is that part of what it means to be a simple pendulum?
Yes, exactly. What else?
We have assumed the pendulum bob is a point mass, meaning it has no shape and zero size.
And we have assumed there is no friction, either with the medium the pendulum bob is moving through, or between the string and whatever it is attached to at the very top.
Exactly. A simple pendulum assumes the string has mass small enough relative to the mass of the pendulum bob that the mass of the string is negligible. The pendulum bob is a point mass, and there is no friction. One other assumption about simple pendulums is that the string is inextensible.
Inextensible?
Incapable of being extended.
Yeah, the length of the string will never change.
All right, we are back to asking Billy what the restoring force for a pendulum is. Billy?
The restoring force for a pendulum. Well, a restoring force is a force which is always directed towards equilibrium and proportional to distance from equilibrium. For a pendulum, that is the component of the force of gravity on the pendulum bob, which acts tangent to the direction of the motion of the pendulum. Do you want me to solve for the equation for force of gravity tangential?
Yes, Billy, that would be great. Thanks.
Well, the angle for a pendulum is between the string and the vertical. That is the same as the angle in the vector triangle where we break force of gravity into its components in the tangential and out directions. So
is correct, Billy.
Nice. Sine of theta equals opposite over hypotenuse. Opposite theta is the force of gravity tangential, and on the hypotenuse is the force of gravity. Therefore, the force of gravity tangential equals the force of gravity times sine of theta, or mass times gravitational field strength times sine of theta.
Thanks, Billy. Now we can sum the forces in the tangential direction. That equals the positive of the force of gravity tangential, which also equals mass times acceleration tangential. Substituting in the negative of the equation Billy just solved for gives us the negative of mass times gravitational field strength times sine theta equals mass times tangential acceleration.
Hold up. Where did the negative come from?
We did this last time. Because the force of gravity tangential is always directed opposite the displacement from equilibrium, it is a restoring force. That means the tangential acceleration and angular displacement theta are always right. opposite in directions. That's where the negative comes from.
No matter which side of equilibrium the pendulum bob is on, the angular displacement and angular acceleration are always opposite in direction. Thanks.
Yeah.
Yes, thanks. Substituting in the equation Billy solved for gives us the negative of mass times gravitational field strength times sine theta equals mass times tangential acceleration. Now realize tangential acceleration is the second derivative of position with respect to time. However, this is not linear motion. This is motion along an arc. Therefore, this position is arc length. Tangential acceleration equals the second derivative of arc length with respect to time, and
everybody brought mass to the party. Everybody brought mass.
Now, arc length equals radius times angular position. The radius for the motion of the pendulum is the length of the pendulum, capital L.
And remember, the length of the pendulum is the distance from the center of suspension to the center of mass of the pendulum, not just the length of the string.
That is correct, Billy. We can use this equation to identify that an infinitesimally small distance along the arc length ds equals the length of the pendulum times an infinitesimally small displacement d theta. How is that helpful for our derivation?
That means the second derivative of arc length with respect to time equals L times the second derivative of angular position with respect to time.
And we can divide by the length of the pendulum.
We are so close to the simple harmonic motion equation, only we have sine theta instead of x.
Yeah, we just need theta instead of sine theta on the right-hand side of the equation.
I feel like this is where we use the fact that the simple pendulum period equation is only valid for pendulum angles that are less than 15 degrees.
Yeah.
That is correct. This is where we use the small angle approximation. The small angle approximation states that the sine of theta and theta are approximately equal to one another for small angles.
Small angles?
Who gets to decide if the angle is small?
Yeah.
Right. That is a reasonable question. First off, realize the small angle approximation is only valid when the angle is in radians. And let's see how this holds up for an angle of 15 degrees. The angle Bo mentioned earlier as the maximum angle for a simple pendulum to be considered to be in simple harmonic motion. Bobby, please convert 15 degrees to radians and take the sine of that angle.
To convert an angle of 15 degrees to radians, we multiply by pi radians over 180 degrees, which is 0.2618 radians. And the sine of that equals 0.2588, which is pretty close to 0.2618.
Correct, Bobby. At 15 degrees, when converted to radians, there is roughly a 1% difference between the sine of the angle and the angle. Typically, between 10 and 15 degrees as a maximum value for theta is where the small angle approximation is considered to be valid. Just realize that the larger the angle, the larger the error in this approximation. And definitely do not go over 15 degrees. Now, we can substitute theta in for sine of theta, and we see that we have an equation which satisfies the condition for simple harmonic motion. The second derivative of angular position with respect to time equals the negative of the gravitational field strength over length all times angular position. Billy, please determine the angular frequency and period of a pendulum in simple harmonic motion.
Absolutely. Well, we know the condition for simple harmonic motion is the second derivative of position with respect to time equals the negative of the square of angular frequency times position. We can replace linear position with angular position, And the square of angular frequency equals gravitational field strength, little g, divided by pendulum length. So angular frequency equals the square root of gravitational field strength divided by pendulum length. We also know period equals 2 pi divided by angular frequency. We derived that last time. Substitute in the square root of gravitational field strength divided by pendulum length for angular frequency, and we get that the period of a simple pendulum when the angle is less than 15 degrees equals 2 pi times the square root of the quantity pendulum length divided by gravitational field strength, the equation Bo gave us earlier.
Very nice, Billy. Thanks. We can extend this to the equations for position, velocity, and acceleration as a function of time for the pendulum as well. We already derived the linear equations using a mass spring system. Notice the derivation of the angular equations of motion for a simple pendulum are very similar. We simply replace all of the linear variables with angular variables. For example, rather than linear position as a function of time equals amplitude times cosine of the quantity angular frequency times time plus phi, the phase constant, we have angular position as a function of time equals maximum angular position times cosine of the quantity angular frequency times time plus phi, the phase constant. We can do the same thing with the velocity and acceleration equations. Please make sure you remember to use radians in all of these equations. Realize that means amplitude or theta maximum for a simple pendulum is measured in radians. And the equations for the maximum value of each of these works out to be the same as well. Angular position maximum is just, well, angular position maximum. Angular velocity maximum equals maximum angular position times angular frequency. Angular acceleration maximum equals maximum angular position times angular frequency squared. And for a simple pendulum, we know angular frequency equals the square root of the gravitational field strength over pendulum length. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.
I have a question. Mr. P, is he gone already? Can one of you help?
Sorry, I have to get to the math club. Bye.
I guess I can help. What's your question?
Well, does omega mean angular velocity or angular frequency?
What do you mean?
One of the equations for the simple pendulum has omega in it three times, and I think it means two different things in the same equation. Angular velocity is a function of time equals the negative of the maximum angular position times angular frequency times the sine of the quantity angular frequency times time plus phi, the phase constant. Does omega really mean two different things in the same equation?
Yeah, I guess it does. Omega stands for the changing angular velocity of the pendulum bob as it moves back and forth as a function of time. And omega stands for the angular frequency of simple harmonic motion, which is a constant number. And for a simple pendulum, angular frequency equals the square root of gravitational field strength over pendulum length. I guess omega does stand for two different things in the same equation. That's not good.
Yeah.